B, coming to the A and the C in the similar pattern, we need A's performance, C's performance, and their F1 cross bred performance. So we calculated mid parental value A plus C divided by 2 is 175.55 gram. Then heterosis percent is MF minus MP, as this is the formula. Then finally, we got negative heterosis here, C minus 5.35 gram. So when we calculated this heterosis percent, it may be sometimes positive, sometimes negative. And accordingly, we have to give our interpretations. Then coming to the direct cross, that is the last cross, B with C. B's average is given, C's average is given, their crossbred average is also given. So we calculated their mid-parental values, 167.5 gram. Substituting in the values, finally we got 7.46% heterosis. These are the direct cross. Coming to the reciprocal cross, the first reciprocal cross is B with A. And here B is used as male line, that is the sire line, then female is A line, or dam line is A line. So their average, again, A and the B average, the same average as in direct cross, we'll be using here. Their F1 cross, that performance is different, that is 195. Average we have calculated, substituting in the formula, finally we got 8.33. And this, as in case of direct cross, that is A as male line, then B as female line, we got around 11%. Then coming to the C with A. So substituting all these values, again here, we got minus 0.422%. So when we cross A with C, that is the direct cross, there also we got negative heterosis. Here also in the reciprocal cross also, we got negative heterosis. Then C with B. C with B here, we calculated as the heterosis after substituting all those values, 10.44%. Now interpretation here is A and the B cross gives maximum heterosis. That is, A line may be used as a male line and B line as female line to produce superior offspring. So out of these three lines given, that is A, B, and C, we have come to the conclusion that A and the B cross gives superior F1 offspring. So A may be kept as a male line, B as a male. Then, however, A line could not combine well with line C as indicated by the negative heterosis, both in direct as well as reciprocal process. So here, one more calculation is required. I am going again to the question. Here in the question, you please have a look again. Calculate the percentage of heterosis for direct, reciprocal, and the combined cross. So combined cross, here I have not calculated. You please try to calculate it. That is how to calculate is for combined cross. This direct cross, that is A and the B, reciprocal cross B and the A, their average we have to take. That is A and the B is 200 gram, B with A is 195 gram. So 200 plus 195 divided by 2. Like that for A and the C, C with the A, their average we have to take and calculate and see the final result. Okay, this part is your homework for your record. Then another example here is this particular example. You please listen carefully, very important one. We have conducted a crossbreeding program for genetic improvement of Haryana cattle using Holstein Friesian cattle. The following production performance were recorded. Have a look here. The production performance we have recorded are aged first calving of Haryana, Holstein Friesian, and they are F1 cross. Male ill, lactation length, dry period, service period, and finally, what is here? 1 minute. Calving interval, okay? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 parameters or traits are given. Based on heterosis percent of these various economic traits, we'll be calculating the heterosis percent. Give your opinion whether the same crossbreeding program should be continued for genetic improvement of Haryana cattle. Means certain informations we have collected after undergoing this type of crossbreeding, that is in between Haryana and the Holstein Friesian. So based on this percent heterosis, we have to give certain recommendations whether this type of crossbreeding between Haryana and the Holstein Friesian should be continued for genetic improvement of Haryana or not. So first, let us calculate the heterosis percent. So first character is AZ first calving. So for Holstein Friesian is given as 40 months. For Haryana, given as 48 months. Their first generation crossbred is 42 months. Then their mid-parented value is 40 plus 48 divided by 2. That is coming as 44 months. Substituting in the value, that is average of F1 minus mid parental value divided by mean parental value, that is finally the heterosis percent is in negative, that is minus 4.54%. So heterosis percent is negative here. Now let us not discuss. Finally, let us give our conclusions once we have completed the calculation part. Then coming to the male ill, the average male ill of Holstein Friesian is 3,000 liter. Haryana is 1,500 liter. Their F1 generation, 1,850 liter. Then their mid-parental value is 3,000 plus 1,500 divided by 2, 2,250 liter. So finally, we got the heterosis as negative. That is minus 17.77%. And again, for male ill also, it is negative. Coming to the lactation length, in the similar pattern, we have calculated, then we got this heterosis percent for lactation length as 3.63%. This is positive. This positive sign indicates that the F1 generations, they are superior over their mid-parental values. Means mid-parental value and their F1 performance is superior to mid-parent, therefore we are getting positive heterosis. Then coming to the dry period, here again in the same pattern we got negative. Negative means the mid-parental value is greater than their F1 generations. That's why as per this formula we got negative estimate, that is minus 3.84% for dry period. Dry period is the period in which the cow is not giving any milk, okay? This happened in the last left stage of the what? Pregnancy. When the animal is pregnant, then she is giving milk, then finally she stops giving the milk for the next calving. Means around say 120 days, means 3 months or 3 to 4 months, around 4 months or 5 months before the final next calving, the cow will stop giving milk so that she can prepare herself physically for the next calving, right? That period is known as dry period. Coming to the service period, I will define here service period. Service period, once the cow has given a calf, our uterus is now empty, no fetus is there. So after around 60 days, that is 2 months or 3 months, she will come into the heat again. During that time, the cow can be inseminated. maybe national service or maybe artificial insemination. So that is the period in which the cow can be given service. So that period is known as service period. If pregnancy happen, then it will go for gestation period. During that period, the cow will not come into heat. So what is this period? From the date of calving till the next conception. So that period where the cow is not under gestation and she is ready for service, comes into the heat. So that particular period is known as service period. So when we calculated the heterosis percent, again here is negative. That means in the F1 generations, the service period is reduced. Coming to the calving interval, that is the period in between two successive calving, first calf, second calf. What is the duration? That is known as calving interval. Here again, we got the negative heterosis, that is 2.43. So again here, calving interval is reduced in class of F1 generation. So what is our interest? Our interest is to have minimum calving interval, means in a very quick way, at the earliest possible, we should get the next calf after getting the first calf or second calf. So that is our interest. Now, coming to the heterosis percent here, I have summed up. AZ first calving is negative, that is desirable. Why? We want our heifer should reach the maturity at the earliest possible. So AZ first calving is reduced. So reduction in the AZ first calving due to this crossbreeding program, that is desirable. We are interested in that way. Male ill, there is negative heterosis, not desirable, because the performance of the F1 generations, that is lower than that of their mid-parental value. Then coming to the lactation length, again, it is lactation length is increased. We want the cow should give more time for this milk yield, that is for longer period of time, she should give milk. That is our interest. Then dry period. Dry period means the cow stops giving milk. What we want from a cow is milk. So if she stops giving milk for a very long period of time, that is undesirable, uneconomical. We don't want to keep that type of cow, not giving milk, only eating. So since it is negative, dry period is reduced. That is preferable. Service period, again, it is negative. It is also good because the cow has given a calf today at the earliest period. In the coming days, she should get conceive. If she is not conceiving for 4-5 months, that is next calving will happen after a very long gap. That is not desirable because cow gives milk only when they have a calf. Then calving interval, again here, the period between two successive calving, that period is reduced. Again, it is desirable. So based on this one, what we can conclude here, in all the traits except male ill, the heterosis percent is in desirable directions. Okay, so that means AZ first calving, dry period, service period, calving interval were reduced in the F1 crossbred offspring compared to Haryana breed. Male ill, although it show negative heterosis, there is negative heterosis. The F1 crossbred performance was better than that of parental breed Haryana. When we compare this F1 crossbred performance for male ill, they show superiority over their parental breed Haryana. So the question here is whether this crossbreeding program should be continued for genetic improvement of Haryana. So since F1 crossbred offsprings are showing better performance as compared to Haryana, that means there is improvement in the crossbred. So in that way, finally, what will be our conclusions? Therefore, it may be suggested to continue the crossbreeding program of Haryana cattle by using Holstein Friesian for increased production performance. So our suggestion is now, this crossbreeding program is beneficial. So it is better to continue this type of crossbreeding program for genetic improvement of Haryana cattle. Okay, this is the heterosis. Now we'll shift to the sire evaluation. It comes most of the time as a short note. So you please have a look about that different types of sire evaluation. What is sire evaluation? Estimation of the expected breeding value of an individual. That is generally males. So those things, that estimation of their expected breeding value, we do by individual selection, family selection, pedigree selection, and like this progeny testing. As we know, progeny testing or progeny selection is the best basis of selection. So once progeny testing is over, the breeding value, expected breeding values of the different sires, we have estimated based on their progeny performance, that is daughter's performance. Then on the average of their daughter's performance, we used to rank the sire, which one is coming in the first rank, second rank, like that. And accordingly, we have selected the best male for breeding purposes. So here, there are certain methods of sire evaluations. Once we have completed the progeny testing program, let us see one by one here what is given. Data pertaining to lactation ill of dams and daughters of three sires are given. Assume that heritability of the trait is 0.4. Herd average, that is population average, is 2,200 kg. Estimate the expected breeding values of these sires and rank them. It is not dumb. It is rank them by different methods. So here we are given three sires. Heritability of the trait is given as 0.4. Population average or herd average is given as 2,200 kg for the lactation male ill. Now, the next information given here is for the sire number one, mated to 5 dams. This sire was mated to 5 different dams on a random basis. And the performance of the dams are given here. Performance of their daughters born are also given here. Similarly, for sire number two also, it is given. Sire number three also, it is given. So based on this information, now we have to calculate what will be the expected breeding value of sire number one, sire number two, and sire number three. So let us see how to calculate. So coming to the solutions, first of all, what we need is total or the sum of the dams bred to sire number one separately, that is the summation M1. M means dam, summation M1, we have calculated. Then their daughter's average is summation D1. Similarly for sire number two, summation M2, summation D2, sire number three, summation M3, summation D3. So these values we have calculated, that is simply the total. Now, the another information given is heritability of the trait is 0.4, herd average is 2,200 kg. So these are the information given. Coming to the evaluation of sires, the first method, the easiest and the commonly used method is simple daughter's average. How to calculate here is index is equal to summation di divided by summation ni. So for sire number one, index one is equal to the total of their daughters, that is summation di, I mean here summation d1, which we have calculated in the table. Then summation n1 means how many daughters are there for this sire. So it is 11,600 divided by 5. So it is coming 2,320. Similarly for sire number two, again, we have calculated index 2, I2 is equal to summation di, here it should be summation d2 divided by summation n2, that is coming as 2,370 kg. Likewise for S3 also we have calculated. So based on this method, that is simple daughter's average, which sire is coming as the top, sire number two is ranked first, 2,320. 2370. Sire number 2, first. Sire number 3, second. And the sire number 1 is the last one, that is third. So this is the expected breeding value. And one more thing here I want to add. Since the sire has transmitted only 50% of its genes to its daughters, due to that 50% genes received from their father, the daughter's performance of these sires are coming like this, 2320, 2370, like that. So the actual performance or the expected breeding value of the sire will be double of this, because sire is having 100% genetic material. Only half is transmitted to the daughter. So the expected breeding value of the sire will be double of this. Once it is double also rank, it will remain the same. But the expected breeding value of the sire will be two times of this, double of this. That you. Now another method is here. Equivalent or intermediate index, that is also known as Yap's index theory. You please read it. Their details are given. The formula here is I is equal to 2 times D minus M. What is D here? Dam's average. M is what? Mother's average. Daughter's average. So for the sire number 1, we have to calculate 2 times average of the dams mated to the sire number 1. Minus average of the D is daughter, M is their mother, I mean dams. So finally, the expected breeding value for sire number 1 is coming as 310 kg. Similarly, for sire number 2, it is coming as 250. For sire number 3 is again 250. So based on this method of sire evaluation, what we got is sire number 1 is ranked first, 310, followed by sire number 2 and 3. But in case of that average daughter's average, sire number 1 was ranked third. But as per this method, it comes out to be the number 1. So here what happened, in case of the daughter's average, we don't consider the performance of the mothers, I mean dams. But here in this method, dams' performance are also considered. So due to the considerations of the dams' records or performance, we got the differences in the ranking of different sires. What I want to say here is, in the simple, that is number 1, the first one, simple daughter's average, what happened, that method is affected by the dam's performance, means that is not a unbiased one. There is some bias due to the differential performance of the different dams. Then sometimes what happened in our progeny testing program, particular sire, say for example, sire number 2 was mated with the superior dams, knowingly or unknowingly. So the contributions of the dam is also there in the performance of their daughter. But our assumption is the increase in the performance of the daughter is due to the contribution of the sire. Then we may be wrong if mother's influence is there. What I want to say here is different sires, they might have been mated with the different dams having differences in their performance. So therefore, dam's performance should be corrected. So once their performance, that is dam's performance, are corrected, sire number 1 is the best sire from the given information. Then coming to the next one, that is corrected daughter's average index. This index is also known as Krishnan index, 1956. Krishnan is an Indian scientist. Okay. Sometimes what happened in the exam, fill up the blanks or multiple choice, or maybe true or false, they may ask, corrected daughter's average is also known as Krishnan index, 1956. Like this, they may ask, or in the form of multiple choice, they may give. So the formula here is the index I is equal to D. D is the dam's performance. minus D is the daughter's performance minus B. B is the regression coefficient. Then M minus A. What is M here? M, mother's performance. Then A is the hard average. So again here, what we do? D is simple daughter's average. As in the first formula, that is simple daughter's average. I was equal to D. Then this additional factor, that is minus B, M minus A, this is known as the correction factor. Means we are correcting the differences in the performance of the different dams, method to different sites, as well as what is the herd average or the population average. That is also taken into consideration. So finally, B is equal to half of the heritability. As heritability is given as 0.4, so B is finally equal to 0.2, right? So now D is, we have calculated, B is 0.2, M is also calculated, A is given in the formula, I mean in the question. So for sire number one, after substituting these different values, we get 2327 kg as is expected index. Then for sire number two also, 2361, 23454 sire number three. So based on this, which sire is coming? The first one, sire number two, right? Sire number two is coming as the first. Second is this one, sire number three. Then last is sire number one. So this particular ranking of the sires by using corrected daughter's average index is almost similar to that of the simple daughter's average, right? So now we can do this index ranking of the sires. Here, simple daughter's average, sire number two first, sire number two second, sire number one third. Equivalent or intermediate index, also known as Yap's index, we got sire number one as the first, sire number two and the three, their expected breeding values are the same. Then coming to the corrected daughter's average index, that is also known as Christensen index, sire number two first, sire number three second, and the sire number one third, similar to that of simple daughter's average. So these are only three formulas, but in theory, I might have given more number of formulas for your theory point of view. Okay, like other things like least square constant, animal model, blob, all those things I might have given more in theory. You please go through for theory exams. Now it is the end of this sire evaluation. Then finally, now I will discuss selection index, that is construction of selection index. Is superior over to that of tandem method and the independent culling level, because in case of selection index, what we do, we have considered the inferiority in certain trait also for an individual, which is not considered in case of independent culling level. Then selection index is constructed based on more than one trait, maybe two, more, maybe three, maybe four, or maybe five. And in case of tandem method, selection is only for one character at a time. Due to these things, selection index is superior. And moreover, for construction of selection index, what we need is heritability of the different traits. Their magnitude is separate, or I mean different. Due to the differences in the magnitude of heritability, the response expected based on their heritability is different for different traits. As we know, response to selection is based on heritability. So those, then there may be genetic correlations between the traits also. Some may be positive, some may be negative, some may be no correlations. So selection for one character may bring improvement in another character if positive correlation is there. If there is no correlation, selection in one character will not bring any improvement in another character. So those many things will be taken care by selection index. Due to that, selection index is the selection. So here, informations given are here like this. We have two characters. We want to construct an index based on two characters. First character is X, second character is Y. Heritability of the X character is 0.25. Heritability of the Y character is 0.36, right? Then phenotypic variance of the first character is 25. Phenotypic variance of the second character is 100. Then genetic correlation between X and Y is 0.43. Phenotypic correlation between X and Y is again 0.78. A1, A2, they are the relative economic weights. Means why we are giving 7 to A2, 3 to A1. There is differences. Why? Because we want to bring more improvement in Y character. Because Y is more important from economic point of view. So that's why these relative economic weights, that is A1 and A2, accordingly, on the basis of the economic importance of the trade, we have given this one. So these are the informations given. Then how to start? As we know, the selection index is equal to, in terms of matrix notation, in terms of matrix, we have given P is into B is equal to Z into A. What is P? Phenotypic variance and the covariance matrix. This we have to derive. B is the vector of unknown weightage, means what should be the weightage given to X and the Y traits. And symbolically, it will be B1 and the B2 because two traits are there. G is genetic variance and covariance matrix. P and the G are equivalent. One is phenotypic, another is genetic. Then A is vector of relative economic weights. This A is small a. Vector of relative economic weights means A1 and A2 that we have given 3 and 7. Now, next step is here. We need to calculate this particular equation, PB is equal to ZA. Then phenotypic variance and covariance matrix P is equal to VPX covariance PXY. Then this covariance PXY is again coming here, covariance PXY in the second row. Then in the diagonal, this is known as diagonal elements. So here is all variance. Here is phenotypic variance of the X trait, phenotypic variance of the Y trait. Similarly, for the weighting factor B, B is B1 and the B2. Then similarly for Z matrix, that is the genetic variance and the covariance matrix. Here in the diagonal, they are the genetic variance. Then off diagonal, they are the covariance. So due to this presence of variance and the covariance, this is known as genetic variance and the covariance matrix. Then A matrix is equal to A1 and the A2. So after this, now from the statistics, what we know? We know that from the statistics, correlation between two traits, here P notified that it is the phenotypic correlation. So correlation between two traits XY is equal to covariance of the phenotypic values of X and Y divided by square root variance of phenotypic variance of X trait into phenotypic variance of Y trait. So we have here this formula from the statistics. Now, finally, covariance PXY is equal to, when we multiply these two, that is phenotypic correlation between X and the Y into square root phenotypic variance of X and the phenotypic variance of Y. Why we are using this formula is, in case of phenotypic variance and covariance matrix, we want covariance PXY. So by substituting these given values, phenotypic correlation is given as 0.78, square root phenotypic variance of X trait 25 into phenotypic variance of Y is 100. So finally, it comes as 39. Then heritability of X, as we know from the knowledge of heritability, it is genetic variance divided by phenotypic variance. Okay. So it is for X trait. Now finally, what we need, BZX, that is genetic variance we want for the matrix. So heritability multiplied by the phenotypic variance, which we have, which is given. So heritability of the X trait is 0.25. Then phenotypic variance is 25. So finally we get 6.25. Similarly for Y trait, that is BZY is equal to heritability of the Y trait into phenotypic variance of the Y trait. So it comes 0.36 into 100 divide is finally coming as 36. Now, as in phenotypic correlation, since the genetic correlation is given, and the formula is the same thing, only in place of P, we use G. G here in the denominator also GG. So covariance between, genetic covariance between X and the Y, we have calculated as 6.45 from the given information. Now, coming to the matrix form. PB is equal to G is the matrix form. Here P, we finally received, got this one. 25 is the phenotypic variance. So 100 is the phenotypic variance of Y. 39, these are the same thing. This is the phenotypic covariance. B1 and B2 are the unknown factors we want to calculate. Then for genetic variance and covariance, from the calculated one, 6.25 is the genetic variance of X trait. 36 is the genetic variance of Y trait. 6.45 of diagonal. They are the genetic covariance. 3 and 7, this is known as what? Relative economic weights. So here, let me again tell you about the matrix. In this first matrix, it has 2 rows and 2 columns. So it is known as 2x2 matrix. Then here in the second matrix, B1 and B2, we have 2 rows, 1 column. 2 rows, and 1 column, 2x1. Then here is again similarly, 2 rows, 2 columns. Then in the last, that is economic, relative economic weights or values, here is 2 rows and 1 column, 2x1, 2 into 1. We used to write 2 into 1. So then from this formula, PB is equal to ZA. If we want to calculate B, that is small b, is equal to GA divided by P. So divided by P, we can write as P inverse 1. So in the matrix form, I am writing here, this is the P matrix inverse 1, I mean 1 upon P. And here is G matrix, here is A matrix. So now let us do the multiplication of the matrix. Now how to do, let us see. First, we want to know what will be the value of this. P inverse. So P inverse, that is 1 by P, is equal to, in terms of matrix, adjoint. This A, D, J dot is known as adjoint. I am telling the spelling complete. A, D, J, O, I, N, T. Adjoint matrix. So adjoint P divided by, here P is in between 2 straight lines. This is known as determinant, P determinant. So for calculation of P inverse, what we need is adjoint P divided by P determinant. So that is, adjoint P is, I have written here in the rightmost side, that is, then P determinant is written here in the denominator, 200 minus 39. Now here, please have a look. In the previous matrix, I am showing, going back again one slide here. P is here, 25, 39, 39, 100. So when we do this P adjoint matrix, what we do, 25 and 100, we interchange this one. In place of 25, 100 will be there. In place of 100, 25 will be there. Then 39, 39, they are the same value. Even if we interchange also, they will remain the same. Only thing is here, they are positive. So we will convert them into negative. So please have a look here. 100 comes here, 25 comes down. So 39 becomes minus, 39 becomes minus. This is known as adjoint. Then coming to the determinant, P determinant. 25 into 100 minus 39 square. So 25 into 100 means this diagonal element, we took the multiplication. 25 into 100 minus this 39 into 39. So 39 square. So this is there. Then finally, after simplification, it becomes 1 upon 979. And when we want to open this bracket, as we know, we have to multiply 1 by 979 to each and every elements. That is 100 minus 39 minus 39, 25. So after this, finally, we got a matrix of 2 by 2. That is 2 rows and the 2 columns. So this is what your P inverse, that is phenotypic variance and the covariance matrix in the form of inverse. Now, B1, B2 is equal to, so this P inverse, now we have calculated. So now we are writing in the, this P inverse. Then this is the genetic variance and covariance matrix. And here is your relative economic weights. Now, how to do this multiplication here? Please listen it carefully. For exam point of view, it is very important. Now, how to multiply this matrix is, we want to multiply the past two matrix. Okay, 2 by 2, 2 by 2, 2 by 2, 2 by 2. So this past element is multiplied by the past element of the second matrix. So that is 6.25. We have done here. Plus, this second element, I mean, in the past row, second element is multiplied by the what? By 6.4. The second element. Then, so finally it comes like this. Then the next element, it will be here how? This one, 6.45 in the past row, second element, it multiplies to the past. Then minus means it is plus into minus, it becomes minus. Then second element here, it is minus 0.0398 into 36. Means this second column we have to consider, right? Then similarly here, in the second row, past element, this minus 0.0398 is multiplied by the past element 6.25. Okay, then this second element 0.0255 is multiplied by the 6.45. Okay, then next is the second column of the second matrix. It will multiply to this minus 0.03 into 6.45 plus 0.0255 into 36. So here it is. You just practice it, then you will get it. Then 3 and 7, this last matrix, it will remain as such. Now, after simplification, we got these 2 by 2 matrix again. Now we have only 2 matrix. One is 2 by 2, another is 2 by 1. So how to multiply again here? How to simplify this one? 0.3814 is multiplied by 3 plus, here is minus, minus 0.7743. So I am writing here minus. Plus into minus is minus, multiply by 7. Okay, first row we have completed. Now coming to the second row. Second row, first element is multiplied by 3 plus second element of the second row is multiplied by 7. So finally we got this right-hand matrix that is only 2 by 1 matrix. So what it shows, B1 is equal to minus 4.2. B2 is equal to plus 4.3761. So we have calculated B1 and B2 like this. Now our index, final index will be I is equal to B1 X1 plus B2 X2. Theoretically, you might have learned. So I is equal to B1 is minus 4.2759 into X plus 4.3761 into Y. This is the index. Now for the first animal, if we want to have the index, the performance of the first individual, let us take X is the age at first calving, Y is the mill ill. So the X is the age at first calving. For the first cow, we have the value, substitute here X, then mill ill we have, that is represented by Y, then we will have a final value of I for first cow. For the second cow also, third cow, like that. So 100 cows, we can calculate their respective index. Based on that index, we can select which are the superior cows in our population genetics, populations. Now coming to the total genetic sense, what is total genetic sense means? Due to this selection index, if we are using this selection index, then what will be the improvement in terms of selection or genetic gain is equal to I square root B prime, this is B prime, and B, P into B. So by using this relationship, we can calculate. Now let us see how we have calculated. Again here, P we have calculated as minus C. One thing I will tell you, here is your B matrix. B1, B2 is now we have calculated as minus 4.2. So here is only one column. Two rows. So only one column, this type of matrix is known as column matrix. Okay. This column matrix here, B prime, we converted into row matrix. Only here one row is there, two columns. So it is known as row matrix. Or then P, we have 2539, 3900. Then B, SS, I am writing here. So after doing this whole simplification of the matrix, multiplications and all, finally we got B prime, B is known as here B transpose into P into B is 912.59. So substituting this 912.59, then intensity of selection I we have taken as 1, then finally it comes as 30.21. That means expected genetic improvement in the population is 30.21. So this last part, please see how I have calculated. Then up to this construction of selection index, and moreover this selection index topic is very important for your examination and point of view. So you please read it. If anybody is having any problem or any confusion, you can discuss with me, right? So for today, I am winding up your class here. And for practical, I am finishing for second year. Up to here, your syllabus will be, that is what? Response to selection, inbreeding coefficient, relationship coefficient, sire evaluation, then this heterosis, selection index. So these are the syllabus for your practical. Then if in between, if any of you is having any problem, you can contact me or you can discuss with me. So for today, bye. All of you, stay safe. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.